there are big hoardings and posters in states like Tamil Nadu and Rajasthan which says spend 500 rupees and save 5 lakh rupees. What does it mean? That spend rupees 500 on medical examinations like amniocentesis or ultrasonography and identify that the child the mother is carrying, if it's a female, you can abort it and you save 5 lakh rupees. How? The couple of lakhs you spend on upbringing her and the remaining lakhs of rupees you spend on giving dowry. According to the report of the government hospital of Tamil Nadu, out of every 10 female children that are born, 4 are put to death. No wonder the female population in India is less than the male population. Female infanticide was continuing in our country since centuries. If you analyze the statistics of the 1901 census, for every 1,000 male, there were 972 females, according to the 1981 statistics and census. It tells you, for every 1,000 male, you had 934 females. And the latest statistics of 1991 tells you that for every 1,000 males, you have 927 females. You can analyze that the female ratio is dropping every year. And since science and medicine has advanced, it has helped in this evil practice. Just because Islam tells you that you should not kill any children, whether it be male or female, will you call these rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Islam not only prohibits killing of infant children, it also prohibits and it rebukes you on rejoicing on the birth of a male child and you getting saddened on the news of a female child. If you read Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 58 and 59, it tells you that when news is brought to one of them of a birth of a female child, his face darkens and he's filled with inward grief. He hides himself in shame from his people because of the news he has received. Should he let her live in suffering or should he bury her in dust? Ah, what an evil choice they have. Quran not only prohibits female infanticide, it rebukes at the thought of you rejoicing at the birth of a male child and getting saddened at the birth of a female child. In Islam, a daughter should be brought up correctly. And according to a hadith in Ahmad, the Prophet may peace be upon him, he said, anyone who brings up two daughters properly, they will be like this to me on the day of judgment. Means will be very close to me on the day of judgment. And there's another hadith which says that anyone who upbrings two daughters properly and takes good care and brings them up with love and affection, they will enter paradise. In Islam, there should be no partiality in upbringing of the daughters of the son. According to a hadith of a beloved prophet, it said that in the presence of the prophet, once a man kissed his son and placed him on his lap, but did not do the same to his daughter. The prophet immediately objected and said that you are unjust. You should have even kissed your daughter and placed her on the other lap. Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he did not only speak about justice, he also practiced it. Let's analyze the rights of a wife in Islam. all the previous civilizations, they have considered the woman to be an instrument of the devil. The Quran refers to the woman as Muhsana, that is a fortress against the devil. And if a woman who's good marries a man, she prevents him from going on the wrong path and keeps him on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, that the correct path. There's a hadith in which Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he said that there is no monasticism in Islam. And again, according to Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, chapter number 3, hadith number 4, it says that the Prophet ordained the young men, all those who have the means to marry, they should marry, for it will help them to lower their gaze and guard their modesty. There is another hadith related by Anas, in which the Prophet said, anyone who marries completes half his deen. Once somebody asked me that, does it imply that if I marry twice, I'll be completing my full deen? The person misunderstood the message of the Prophet. When the Prophet said that when you marry, you complete half your deen, it means that when you marry, it shields you from promiscuity. It shields you from fornication. It shields you from homosexuality, which lead to half the sin in this world. Only when you marry do you have opportunity to become a husband or a wife. Only when you marry do you have opportunity to become a father or a mother. And the duties of the mother and the father and that of a husband and wife are very important in Islam. So it makes no difference whether a man marries once, twice, or thrice, or four times, he yet completes only half his deen. The Quran says that we have put love into the hearts of the husband and wife. If you read Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 21, it says that, and amongst our signs, we have created for you mates or companions, so that you may dwell in them in tranquility. And we have put love and mercy between your hearts. According to Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 21, marriage is considered as a misaq, a sacred agreement, a sacred contract. According to Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 19, it says, you are prohibited to inherit women against their will. Means, to marry, the permission of both the parties are required. It's compulsory that the man and woman both should agree to marry. No one, not even the father, can force their daughter to marry against her wishes. There's a hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, chapter number 43, hadith number 69, which says that a lady, she was forced by her father to marry against her wishes, and she went to the Prophet, and the Prophet invalidated the marriage. And the hadith in Ibn Hanbal, hadith number 2469, it says that a daughter was forced by a father to get married, and when the daughter approached the Prophet said, you can either continue, or if you wish, you can invalidate the marriage. That means the consent of both the male and the female is required. In Islam, a woman is considered as a homemaker. She is not considered as a housewife because she is not married to the house. Many people use terminologies without understanding what it means. Housewife means you're the wife of the house. So I believe from now onwards, the sisters would prefer calling themselves homemakers than housewives if they occupied more in the home. in Islam, a woman, she is not married to a master that she should be treated like a slave. She is married to its equal. And there's a hadith which says in Ibn Hanbal, hadith number 7396, it says that the most perfect of the believers are those that are best in character and behavior, and those that are best to their family and their wives. Islam gives equal rights to the man and woman. And as mentioned by the Honorable Justice M.M. Qazi, the Quran clearly mentions that men and women, husband and wife, have equal rights in all aspects except leadership in the family. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 228. It says that the woman has been given rights similar to as against them on equitable terms, but the men have a degree higher. And I perfectly agree with Justice M.M. Qazi when he said that most of the Muslims have misunderstood this verse when it says a man have a degree higher. As I said, we should analyze the Quran as a whole. And it's mentioned in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 34, which says, Al-Rijalu Qawwamuna ala Nisa, that the men are the protectors and maintainers of the women. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given one of them more strength than the other, and they give them the means. People say the word Qawwam means one degree higher in superiority. But actually the word Qawwam comes from the root word ikama. Ikama means, for example, when you give the ikama before prayers, you stand up. So ikama means to stand up. So the word qawwam means one degree higher in responsibility, not one degree higher in superiority. Even if you read the commentary of Ibn Qasir, he says that the word qawwam means one degree higher in responsibility, not one degree higher in superiority. And this responsibility should be carried out by mutual consent of both husband and wife. It's mentioned in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 187, which says, Hunna libasun lakum wa antum libasun lahunna, which means your wives are your garments and you are their garments. What's the objective of garments? It's used to conceal and to beautify. The husband and wife should conceal each other's faults and they should beautify each other. It's a relationship of hands and gloves. The Quran mentions that even if you don't like your wife, you should treat her kindly. It's mentioned through Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 19, that treat your wife on a footing of equity and kindness even if you dislike her. For you may be disliking a thing for which Allah has made good for you. Even if you dislike your wife, you have to treat her kindly and with equity. Just because the rights of a wife are equal to those of the husband in Islam, will you call such rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Let's analyze the rights of a mother. The only thing above respect to mother, it is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's mentioned chapter number 17, verse number 28 and 29. It says that Allah has ordained for you, that Allah has ordained for you that you worship none but Him, and that you be kind to your parents. And if anyone or both of them reach old age, do not say a word of contempt or repel them, but address them with honor and speak to them with kindness and lower your wing of humility and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my Lord, bless them as they have cherished me in childhood. Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 1 says, respect the womb that bore you. Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 151 says, وَبِالْوَالِدِهِ that you have to be kind to your parents. Again, in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14, it again says the same thing. وَوَسَيَّنَ الْإِنسَانَ بِالْوَالِدَهِ أَحْسَانَ that we have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to his parents. In travail upon travail did the mother bore them, and in years to end were they weaning. A similar thing is repeated again in Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 46, verse number 15. Again the same thing. وَوَسَيَّنَ الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدِهِ أَحْسَانَ that we have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to his parents. In pain did the mother bore them, and in pain did she give them birth. According to a hadith related in Ahmad as well as in Ibn Majah, it says paradise lies at the feet of the mother. That does not mean that if my mother is walking on the road and if she steps on muck and filth, that thing becomes paradise. It means that after you fulfill your basic duties, if you respect your mother, if you're kind to your mother, if you're honorable to your mother, you will inshallah enter paradise. And the hadith related in Sahih Bukhari in volume 8, chapter number 2, hadith number 2, as well as in Sahih Muslim, it says that a man asked the Prophet, who requires the maximum love and respect and my companionship in this world? The Prophet replied, your mother. Who is next? Your mother. Who is next? Your mother. The man asked for the fourth time, who is next? The Prophet replied, your father. 75% of the love and respect goes to the father. Goes to the mother. And 25% of the love and respect goes to the father. 3/4 of the better part of the love and respect goes to the mother. 1/4 of the remaining part of the love and respect goes to the father. In short, the gold medal goes to the mother, the silver medal goes to the mother, the bronze medal goes to the mother, and the father maybe gets a consolation prize. I'm very happy that my brothers appreciated it. As normally, I always apologize that if I've hurt the feelings of my brothers, I'm sorry. That's what Islam tells me. But I'm glad that my brothers here, they've appreciated Islam. Alhamdulillah. Let's analyze the rights of the sisters in Islam. According to Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 71, it says, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَا بَعْضُ that the men and the women, the maintainers and supporters of each other. The word awliya here means supporters and maintainers. They're supporters and maintainers of each other. In short, they are brothers and sisters unto each other, unless otherwise. Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he said, the women are the shakat. Shakat means sister. It also means half, as humankind has been divided into two halves, men and women. It refers to as half, also as sisters. There are so many social rights that we can speak for weeks together. But due to short of time, I will not be able to touch on the important topics such as polygamy, such as divorce, such as talaq, divorce. Because I have opted to spend more time on the other topics, because experience tells me that these topics, inshallah, will be covered in the question answer time. And I hope you will ask questions, and whatever clarification require on this topic, I'll try my level best to give you. Now let's analyze the educational rights given to the woman in Islam. The first 5 verses which were revealed of the Quran Sharif were from Surah Alaq or Surah Iqra, chapter number 96, verse number 1 to 5, which says, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. Read, recite, or proclaim in the name of the Lord. خلق الإنسان من علق. Who has created the human beings from a congealed clot of blood, a leech-like substance. اقرأ ربك الأكرم. Read, thy Lord is most bountiful. الذي علم بالكلم. Who has taught the use of the pen. علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Who has taught the human beings that which he knew not. The first guidance given in the Quran Sharif to the humankind was not to pray, was not to fast, was not to give charity, it was read. Islam pays utmost importance to education. The Prophet ordained the parents, the father and the mother, to see to it that they gave religious education to their daughters. And after a lady married, it was the duty of the husband to provide her with the religious education. If he couldn't do it himself, and if she wanted, he should allow her to go somewhere else to acquire the education. According to Sahih Bukhari, the women were very enthusiastic to acquire knowledge, and they once told the Prophet, "You are usually surrounded by men. Why don't you give us one particular day so that we too can ask you questions?" And the Prophet agreed. Besides he himself going, he sent many other of his sahabas to the women to give them education. Imagine, 1400 years ago, when the women were ill-treated and were only used as chattels, leave aside being educated, Islam asked the women to be educated. We have examples of several Muslim women who are scholars. And the best example I can give you is of Bibi Aisha. May Allah be pleased with her, who was the daughter of Hazrat Abu Bakr, the first Khalifa of Islam. May Allah be pleased with him. And the wife of our beloved Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. She gave guidance even to the Sahabas and to the Khalifas. One of her famous students, Urwa Ibn Azubair, she said that I have not seen a greater scholar than Aisha in the field of learning of the Quran, in obligatory duties, in lawful and unlawful matters, in literature and poetry, in Arab history. She was not only expert in the religious field, she had profound knowledge of medicine. Whenever the foreign delegates came to the Prophet and discussed, she used to memorize the remedies. She was well versed in the field of maths, and many times the companions came to her to ask problems of mirath, that is inheritance, and how much share should be given to the each individual. She said to have guided all the four Khalifas, including the companions. And she also gave guidance many a time to Abu Huraira. May Allah be pleased with him. And she herself has narrated 2,210 hadiths. According to Abu Musa, who was a famous jurist, he said that whenever we companions had lack of knowledge on a matter, we went to Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, and definitely she had knowledge about it. She said to have taught more than 88 scholars. In short, she was a scholar of the scholars. There are several examples. Even of Safiya, may Allah be pleased with her, was the wife of the Prophet, who was an expert in fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence. And according to Imam An-Nawawi, she was the most intellectual woman of that time. Another example is Umm Salma, may Allah be pleased with her, was the wife of the beloved Prophet. According to Ibn Hajar, she has taught 32 different scholars. There are several examples. Fatima bint Qais, she said to have a discussion on fiqh for a full day with Hazrat Aisha and Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with them both, and still they could not prove her wrong. According to Imam An-Nawawi, She migrated in the early days and she had profound knowledge. Other examples like Umm Salim, who was the mother of Anas. She is said to be very well versed in the field of Dawah. Other examples are Sayyida Nafisa, who was a granddaughter of Hassan. And she is also said to have taught Imam Shafi, who was the founder of one of the schools of thought. There are several examples. Even Umm al-Darda was the wife of Abu al-Darda. She is said to be an expert in science. And even Imam Bukhari has said that she was an expert in a field. You can give several examples. At a time when the women were ill-treated, at a time when women were buried alive when they were born, at that time, Islam had women scholars in the field of medicine, in the field of science, in the field of religion. Because Islam tells that every woman should be educated. Will you call such women's rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Let's discuss the legal rights given to a woman in Islam. According to the Islamic law, men and women are equal. The Sharia protects the life and property of a man and woman both. If a man murders a woman, he too will receive the hajj punishment, that's capital punishment of Qisas, according to Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 178 and 179. He too shall be killed. Likewise, if a woman murders, she too will be killed. According to the Islamic law of Qisas, men and women, irrespective the injury be of the eye, of the nose, of the ear, of the body, both receive equal punishment. And if the guardian of the murderer, even if it be a woman, if she says that forgive the murderer and she accepts the yah, that's compensation, her opinion cannot be rejected. They have to accept it. And if there's different opinion between the relatives of the person who's murdered, and some say that the murderer should be killed and some say that he should be forgiven and the yah should be accepted, people should prevent the relatives from killing that murderer. And irrespective whether the witness or the opinion is given by man or woman, it has same weight. According to Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter number 5, verse number 38, it says, as to the thief, whether he be man or a woman, cut off his or her hand as a punishment for his crime, an example from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means if a person robs, irrespective whether he's a man or a woman, his or her hand should be chopped. The punishment is the same. According to Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 2, it says, if any commits fornication, be it a man or a woman, flog them with 100 stripes. The punishment for fornication in Islam, irrespective whether it's a man or a woman, it's the same. Flogging with 100 stripes. The punishment for men and women is the same in Islam. In Islam, a woman is allowed to give witness. Imagine, Islam gave right to a woman to be a witness 14 centuries ago. Even now, in as late as 1980, the Jewish rabbi, they were considering that whether the woman should be given a right to act as a witness or not. And Islam gave that right 1400 years ago. According to Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 4, it is said that if any of you put a charge against the chastity of a woman, produce 4 witnesses. And if they falter, flog them with 80 stripes. In Islam, for a small crime, you require 2 witnesses. For a big crime, you require 4 witnesses. Accusing a woman falsely is a big crime in Islam. Therefore, you require four witnesses. Nowadays, you see in the modern society, you find men abusing women and calling them all sorts of names. They call them prostitutes, etc. And what nothing is done. In an Islamic state, if a man calls her a prostitute in public or anywhere else, and if she takes that man to court, and if that man cannot produce four witnesses, or even if he produces four witnesses, and if any one of them falter, all of them will receive 80 lashes each. And in future, all the evidence will be rejected. Islam gives utmost importance to the chastity of the woman. When a lady marries, she normally adopts the name of her husband. In Islam, she has the option of either keeping her husband's name, either adopting the name of the husband, or maintaining her maiden name. And maintaining the maiden name is recommended in Islam. And you find in several Muslim societies that women, even after they get married, they maintain their maiden name. Because according to the Islamic law, men and women are equal. Will you call such rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Let's analyze the political rights. According to Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 71, which I quoted earlier, which says, "Wal mu'minuna wal mu'minatu, ba'zum awliya ba'z," which says the men and the women, they're supporters of each other. Supporters not only socially, even politically. If politically, the men and women should support each other. Islam gives women the right to vote. If you read Surah Al-Mumtahina, chapter number 60, verse number 12, it says that, "O Prophet, when the believing women come to thee with an oath of fealty," here the Arabic word is bayan. And bayan means much more than our modern present day election. Because Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he was not only the messenger of Allah, but he was also the head of the state. And women came to the Prophet and they agreed with him being the head of the state. So Islam gives the woman even the right to vote. Women can even take part in lawmaking. And according to the famous hadith, in which Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he was discussing with the Sahabas and considering putting an upper limit on the mahar, since young men were being discouraged from getting married. A lady from the back seat, she objected and said, when the Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 20, that you can even give a heap of treasure, a heap of gold in mahar, when Quran puts no limit on mahar, who is Umar to put a limit? May Allah be pleased with him. And immediately, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, Umar is wrong and the lady is right. Imagine, she was a common lady. If it would have been a famous lady, the name of the lady would have been mentioned in the hadith. Since the hadith does not mention the name of the lady, we can understand that the lady was a common lady. Means even a common lady can object to the Khalifa, the head of the state. And in technical terms, it will be called that she's objecting to the breach of the constitution, because Quran is the constitution of the Muslims. That means a woman can even take part in lawmaking. Women have even taken part in the battlefields. There's a full chapter in the Sahih Bukhari mentioning women in the battlefield. Women gave water, they gave first aid to the soldiers, and there is a particular mention of a woman by the name of Nasiba, who were among the few who protected our beloved Prophet during the Battle of Uhud. Because the Quran says, man is the protector of the woman. Under normal circumstances, the woman should not go to the battlefield. It's the duty of the man only when required. Under necessity are the women allowed and they should go to the battlefield. Otherwise, no. Otherwise, you will have the same position as you are having in the USA. There, women were allowed to join the battle since 1901, but they were not allowed to take active part. They only played the part of a nurse. Later on, after the feminist movement just had started, in 1973, the feminist movement demanded, why aren't women allowed to take active part in the battlefield? So the American government allowed, after 1976, women were allowed to take active part in the battlefield. And last year, according to a report of the Defense Department, of the Defense Department of America, which was released on the 23rd of April, 1993, it said that 90 people were sexually assaulted in a convention, out of which 83 were women, and 117 officers were charged with indisciplinary action. Imagine, in one convention only, 83 women sexually assaulted. What was the crime of those 117 officers? They made the women run and they snatched at the clothes. They made them parade absolutely nude without even covering the genital parts. They were made to have sex in public. Is this what you call women's rights? If you think that this is what a woman's right, then you can keep your rights to yourself. We don't want our sisters, our daughters, our mothers to be sexually assaulted. And there was an uproar in the parliament, and the president, Bill Clinton, he himself had to apologize, publicly apologize, and he said, necessary action will be taken. And you know, when politicians say necessary action will be taken, what happens? So Islam allows women to take part in the battlefield only when required. But there also they should maintain the Islamic hijab and the Islamic ethics and the modesty. Before I conclude my talk, I'd like to give an example. As I said in the beginning of my talk, Islam believes in equality between men and women. Equality does not mean arnicality. Suppose in a classroom, two students, student A and B, during an examination, both come out first. Both secure 80% marks, 80 out of 100. Out of the hundreds of students, two come out first, A and B. When you analyze the question paper has 10 different questions, each carrying 10 marks. In question 1, student A got 9 out of 10, and student B got 7 out of 10. So in question 1, student A was higher than student B. In question 2, student A got 7 out of 10, and student B got 9 out of 10. Student B was higher than student A in question number 2. In question 3, both of them got 8 out of 10, both were equal. When you add up the marks of all the 10 questions, both student A and B got 80 out of 100. So in short, student A and student B are overall equal. In some question, A is higher than B. In some question, B is higher than A. In others, both are equal. In the same fashion, taking the example that since Allah has given man more strength, suppose a thief enters the house. Will you tell, I believe in women's rights? I believe in women's rights. Will you tell your mother, your sister, and your daughter to go and fight the thief? No, but naturally you'll fight him. If required, they may interfere. Under normal circumstances, since Allah has given you more physical strength, you have to go and tackle the thief. So here, in physical strength, man is one degree higher than the woman. Let's take another example. Where it comes to giving respect to the, where it comes to respecting the parents. The children are supposed to respect the mother 3 times more than the father. Here, the women have 1 degree higher than the men. Overall, both are equal. So Islam believes in equality, not identicality. Men and women are overall equal in Islam. This was in brief, not in detail, as Justice Qazi said. Time does not permit me to speak in detail. This was in brief, the highlights of the women's rights in Islam. After this, what the Muslim society did is different. Many of the Muslim societies did not give the women their rights and they deviated away from the Quran and the Sunnah. The Western society is largely responsible for this. Because of the Western societies, many Muslim societies have become overprotective, overprecautious, and have gone to one extreme and deviated away from the Quran and the Sunnah. On the other extreme, some of the Muslim societies agreed with the Western culture and followed their culture. I want to tell the Western society that if you analyze the women's rights in Islam according to the Quran and the Sunnah, you will realize it's modernizing and not outdated. Lastly, I would like to thank those people who have helped and supported me. If there is any one person who requires credit for me being here, it's my beloved mother, Mrs. Roshan Naik. It was because of her love, care, and guidance that I'm here today. I'll be doing injustice if I do not include the name of my father, Dr. Abdul Karim Naik, as well as my other family members, especially my brother, Dr. Muhammad Naik, and last but not the least, my wife, who has encouraged me since the last 1.25 years since we have been married, and thus I've been able to strive harder in this field. وآخر الدعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.